The second half of the mobile track will be kickstarting now, and this track focuses more on monetization. How do you actually make money from your apps? We have lined up some very interesting sessions here, followed by a developer who's actually done that and made a lot of money. So like a sort of a case study session, and then that gets rounded up with a session from somebody from Intel, which is going to be giving a forward-looking view of where this is all headed. So I want to introduce Prateek Shah, and his session is going to be on how do you add intelligence to your app? Like how do you do it more intelligently? Quick intro on Prateek. Prateek was a software engineer building trading software for stock markets in New York, caused the collapse, ran away, went to some hiking stuff on Everest, came back, and he's now become a product manager, and he's actually helping app developers to build better apps and get money out of their apps. So that's Prateek's background, and Prateek, come on and over to you.
Perfect. Thank you, Ashwin. Can you guys hear me loud and clear? Perfect. Great. So how many people over here are app developers or have an app in the system right now? Okay, fair, good enough number. What kind of apps, if I may know? Perfect. Pretty much everything. Right? Okay. So I'm going to talk about how do you actually add intelligence in the way in which you run your app business itself. Question for everyone, right? What do these companies or really entities have in common? Any guesses whatsoever? Not bad, actually, right? You're right. It's actually analytics data. But it's much more than that, right? It's the focus on customers and then using analytics and data in a smart way to actually do something relevant for the customers, right? Because analytics and data is great, but what you can do out of that is even more interesting. So this is all great, right? But how is this relevant to an app developer? So the way it's going to be relevant is that I've actually had the good fortune of speaking to a lot of sophisticated app developers, and these guys really have nailed it in the way they run their business, the way they not just analyze people and analyze data, the way they actually change their business for every customer, right? And I'm gonna walk you through some of the best practices that I believe I've seen. Some very interesting best practices, and finally move on to some use cases, right? Great. So I'll give you a second to sort of take in the cartoon as such, right? And believe it or not, I actually know people and know app developers who are making that kind of money from one single user. We actually have one of them in the audience right now. More importantly, what I'm the biggest fan of is the freemium model. So what is a freemium model? If anyone's not heard about it right now, seriously, go look it up. But it's very simple, actually. Instead of charging upfront for your app, what you can do is now let everyone come into your app for free and then monetize them post-acquisition, right? So the best part of this is that it's not just important or it's not just relevant to games. It's actually moving on to all sort of apps. Like you guys said, camera apps, utility apps. I'm seeing examples of people using freemium model in an awesome way. But there's a catch to it, right? It's not just about saying, hey, I'm going to give my app for free and I'll figure out a way to make money. It's not that easy, unfortunately, right? And that's, you know that by the statistics that we are seeing in the app ecosystem right now. 60%, more than 60% of app developers don't even break even, right? So what do you need to do to actually start making money with the freemium model? How do you become intelligent? Do you really just slap on analytics? Maybe not, right? The problem with that is what you're going to do is you're going to get stuck with metrics. And there's a lot of metrics that you can go through. But the question is, which ones do you use? When do you use those? And most importantly, what do you make out of those, right? The way I've seen really good app developers do this is actually just keep it very simple, right? What they're saying is, look at the ARM cycle, as we call it, really acquisition, retention, monetization. And through this entire funnel, it's the same user, right? What you need to do is simply focus on optimizing that user's lifetime value, also called as LTV in the industry. So for folks who understand or don't understand LTV, it's very simple again. It's actually a simple measurement of what a particular user is going, how worthy is that user in your app for the entire duration of their existence as a customer, right? You calculate it in fairly simple ways, and you can go as complex as you want. The more interesting part to understand about LTV is the fact that it's not just about dollars, right? Or it's not just about money. A variety of other things contribute to LTV, and this could be in terms of, say, virality, them giving you ratings on your app store, loyalty to your app, like time spent over time again and again, right, over days. And all of this contributes to LTV. So really now if you look at it, in order to focus on monetization, and in order to say, hey, show me the money, you actually need to think beyond monetization. So here's another interesting concept that we've seen in the industry, customer segmentation. And this one's sort of been around in the retail industry slash marketing industry for the longest period, right? It's like 10 years plus, there have been variety of books written on this. It's now that actually app developers are starting to realize, hey, what we're running is actually a B2C business. It is not very different from a retail business, right? So how about I use some of the same concepts? So what is customer segmentation? It's very, again, it's essentially a way in which you can say, look, not all my users are the same. What if I could actually specifically make segments or buckets of users based on their behavior or based on certain attributes, right? And these attributes could be loyal users, high-paying users, highly engaged users. And now what if I could treat each one of them differently? Wouldn't that be awesome? So how does it work? Rule engine, a basic way in which you can set rules and say, look, if a particular user has done something, right? Paid more than X dollars, spent time more than Y minutes, or is from a particular country, he or she is in that segment. Great. So this is sort of all the interesting concepts that we've been seeing in the ecosystem. But let's put it to some use, right? Let's see some examples of how people are really using it. So again, going back to the acquisition funnel or the beginning of it, some interesting, like acquisition, obviously Ryan and Frank have spoken a lot about it. What's interesting over here is that there are a few ways in which the app developer has control over this without necessarily paying money. A couple of big ones are cross-promotion and virality. So let's say how you could actually do this, right? Again, ways in which really, really sophisticated developers, I'm talking the kinds of Zingas and the likes, right? What do they do to their app? Right? Identify a pattern. Say, you know what, advanced users in my top app, right, and this is imagining that you have a portfolio of apps, don't have the other app, right? What do you do with those users? The next step is make a segment saying, hey, if the user's crossed 25 levels, qualifies him to be an advanced user, he's really used the app a lot, and doesn't have the other app, that's the time to show him a cross-promotion app message. Second example, highly engaged users, say in a particular region, US, seem to be the folks who are most likely to make your app go viral, right? Perfect. Let's target them. Let's create a segment which actually targets those particular users. And again, you can define highly engaged as spending time in your app, maybe more than X hours, and saying, hey, country equal to US, right? What you can now do is show them a specific message saying, hey, we know that you're really engaged in this app. We know that you love this app. Why don't you share it on Facebook? And you know what? Because of your segmentation, most of those users are actually going to do it. Right? Retention. Retention's, it's really difficult, right? The app or the industry statistics sort of seem to say that most of the users actually leave your app after day one. That's ridiculous, right? What do you do about that? Variety of ways to measure this, but a variety of techniques that we've seen app developers use to actually increase their retention, right? First one, you know what? New users, guys who are coming on your app the first time, it's super critical to give them an awesome experience, right? What are the kind of things that you can do? You can show them a localized message, right? You can say, hey, you know what? We know you're a new user. We know you're from China. How about an interesting message for you, right? You could keep the experience clean. You could say, hey, you know what? We know you're a new user. Let's not show you too many ads. We could, in fact, even bring up a tutorial, right? Where you can say, great, welcome to the app. Here's how you use the app. User engagement. People start dropping off, maybe if not after day one, maybe after a few days. What can you do? Like, if you identify a segment of users who you know are sort of starting to lose attention, interest in your app, few things you could do, right? First, identify them, obviously. Second thing now you can do is you can send them a specific message, again saying, hey, you know what? Your friends are beating you. Why don't you spend some more time on this app? So that has a lot of effect. And finally, monetization, right? Tiered pricing, again, one of the big benefits of freemium model, because now you can actually price your app and any sort of premium content that you have. And again, it's not just virtual goods and games. It actually applies to utility apps, anything that you can have premium features over. And now what you can do is price them differently for different users, because obviously different users value them differently, right? Few interesting things that you can do over here as well. Most apps have a very, very small segment of users, which are the hardcore users, right? Generally 1% of your app. But you know what? They make most of your money. So what you can do now, for especially for these users, is at specific points in your app, right, you're following this segment of users, you realize that they're stuck at a particular level, they're trying to use a particular feature. You know what? Put it then. Like, this is an interesting example with Words with Friends, where I would have actually paid. So I've played this game a lot with my friends, and you know what? There have been times where I've said, is there a way if I could cheat right now? That's a perfect example, right? And finally, vacations, or rather holidays, events, right? These times are probably the best times when you can, again, in some sense, localize your content, make it event specific, and bring that particular message to your user, right? So how does a developer do all this, right? This all sounds great, but you know what? It's actually a lot of work, right? You have to decide what data you want to collect. You have to go ahead and collect them. You now have to actually do big data analysis to segment your users. And hopefully you're talking about users in thousands and maybe millions either, right? And finally, you have to build a messaging service which is global, because users are global, right? So you could do all of that, and we've seen some sophisticated developers try all of that, right? Or you could actually say, is there anything better? Is there anything ready-made, right? So stay tuned. We're coming up with something next week, which will actually help you guys do a lot of this. Thanks.
Thanks, Pratik. So we'll check. Yeah, we'll open up the floor for questions, and let's just raise your hands, and I'll pass the mic around.
Level of information should I stop collecting data? Should I track every tab or is it mainly at a screen level where I tap how many users are coming to this screen, how many users are coming to this screen? It's a gaming app, so chess-based gaming app.
Right. What I do is collect what is interesting for you. So this could be in chess, it could be wins or certain interesting moves that a player is making.
Right.
Collect all of that, right?
A follow-up question is that how do I decide what data would I need in the future? Because when I'm starting off, I have no idea what I can get and what insight can I get out of it.
Great question.
Right? So I really have no idea.
So that's a good question. Right? So one of our advice is obviously to collect as much as you can. In some sense, it doesn't hurt to over-collect information than under-collect.
Mm-hmm.
Most of the providers actually, any analytics provider that you use, is fairly efficient in the way they store the data and the way they collect it, so it shouldn't have any performance issues anyways.
Okay.
Having said that, once it's also, we've also seen this as an iterative process. I mean, unfortunately, with every app or every business,
mm-hmm.
what you're going to realize is that some insights which you thought at the beginning were interesting, are not that interesting, and what you would rather have is something even more interesting. Right? So it is going to be an iterative process,
okay.
But that's actually the whole key of it.
Okay.
Hey guys, while you're taking the questions, can you please go ahead and zip dial? All you have to do is a missed call for yes or no, whether you like the session, was it worth attending? Also, while you're asking a question, the best question has some interesting prizes that you can win. Feel free to ask questions right now. I run a social commerce company, and we recently launched our Windows 8 app.
Yeah.
Okay, just yesterday, and hopefully it will get verified soon. So my question is, in social commerce, right, e-commerce that you're enabling through mobiles today,
right?
What do you think is a better strategy for monetization? I mean, obviously there's the branding, CPI, CPM based for the businesses. There's
the
transactions.
Right.
There are either your SaaS that you can charge from the businesses, or of course the paid profile or paid consumer. Right? So which of these would you recommend and why?
So good question, actually. So in social commerce, I've seen a variety of these models work, right? In some sense, I would say it depends, right? It depends on your business, it depends on whether your users are willing to pay and what value you're offering them to pay them for, right? What's again interesting is that irrespective of the monetization model you use, what's becoming more and more evident in social commerce is the fact that you have to keep them engaged. You have to bring the users over and over back again. You have to figure out interesting ways to do that.
So what is the...
Just raise your hand so that I can come to you. Keep your questions short, please.
So on an average...
I'm Jeff Kola. I'm a telecom industry analyst. We cover smart devices and mobile apps. My question to you is, in your presentation, you talked about differential pricing for different consumer segments. Could you give me an example of an app or a developer who's used it successfully?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. So, variety of examples. I'll start with the usual sort of Zynga pricing, right? Like, I've seen virtual goods which are priced at hundreds of dollars, right? Very specifically targeted to that 1% consumers. That's worked beautifully. Again, non-gaming apps, same thing, right? Like, what you are trying to sell, different people will have different value perceptions of that. And what you need to do is capture that, understand that, and then try pricing it differently, right? Obviously, you won't know what the right price is, but you can try different pricing till you come out with the right price. Does that make sense?
You mentioned earlier about the collection of data,
uh-huh.
Right? Now, there are two aspects to it. One is to what extent can you get into the extent can you collect the data in terms of privacy, the legal issues there.
Mm-hmm.
The other is you're also utilizing the data connectivity of the user. Like that's expensive at the cost of the user,
right?
So that's one aspect. So how do you handle that? And on an average, what is the average data in bytes or in size-wise collected for an app, typical app, a gaming app, for example?
Sure. I mean, it may not be a gaming app, right? So first, in terms of legal and privacy, so think about what you're trying to do, right? You're not trying to collect specific information about a person, right? So you don't
have much interest knowing that this is protein 2. What you're rather trying to understand is how is person X trying to use your app, right? And based on that, what is the right thing to do for that person? So with that, it's fairly PII compliant or legally compliant, right? Where you're not really collecting personal information. So that's the first part of it, right? And the second part, which you said, was how much data is collected? Doesn't that take a lot of user's bandwidth? How much is it stored? So a lot of people, again, do this very smartly. The way they actually send data is not necessarily instantly, right? You can store and forward data so that you actually save every user's bandwidth. Really smart companies would do it very well. And obviously, you should go with known/smart companies when you choose your providers. In terms of the amount of data that you actually collect per app, it varies. It depends highly on the number of users you have for your app. We've seen sort of it goes from a KB or a couple of KBs over days, and obviously depends on the number of users. So.
Yeah, but this control is with the app developer, the app provider, right?
Absolutely.
So this should be known to the user at what, how much of bandwidth is being used, what is this cost, and how much of data is, what level of personal data is being sent, and all those things. That should be aware of the aware to the user, right?
Good question. Right, so
can I answer it?
Yeah, sure.
Okay, as an app developer, we've had about 10-15 million downloads. I really haven't had this complaint from any of my users.
No, I'm saying.
So yeah. What I'm trying to say is that probably more than data analytics and the data that collected data transfer, the amount of bandwidth that probably ads, interstitials, rich media ads, video ads, hog, would be more of a concern. I think people, especially a Western audience, understands that a free app is not truly free, and they've accepted it. I've seen that acceptance. We've had a couple of cases where people did complain,
No, most of them are ignorant.
I think both of you have made a point. So primarily, we'll take it offline. So we noted your point, and we'll discuss if we have enough time at the end of the session in terms of app developers and their experiences, right?
A quick question. When you start creating an app, right, or developing an app, how do you figure out the monetization potential across different platforms, like iOS compared to Android? Because you're not really have any made any user studies for the demand for your apps and stuff like that.
So good question, right? So when you're starting an app, variety of platforms that you're starting on, how do you figure out which is the best model, right?
Monetization as well as how do you decide whether to build a native app compared to something like that works across platforms and stuff like that?
Good question again, right? So one is deciding what kind of should you do per platform, or should you do an app which works across all of them, depends on your app. If it is heavily focused on your user experience, gaming apps or heavy sort of user experience apps, you probably are safer going the native route. Other sort of apps which are not that necessarily UX focused, you could look at variety of platforms. There are hundreds of platforms, right? It depends on which one you want to try, which one works. The second part, which was how do you decide the monetization strategy? Again, we've seen, one is just look at past history, right? And say, okay, look, for iOS games, a lot of people say, hey, for iOS, we're going to go with freemium model. Users pay a lot for these apps, so we'll be fine, we can charge them, right? For Android, a lot of people take the first sort of guess and say, look, Android users, maybe I should show them more ads because they won't pay as much. Right? Again, that's a starting initial assumption. What you'll then realize over days and weeks is what's working. And again, completely different things work specific to your app.
So,
this last question, please.
So, like I have Google Analytics for my website, is there any ready-made platform that I can install on my app within my app core, which will give me analytics out of the box?
Great question. Actually, that's what I was alluding to. We're actually coming out with such a platform next week. Okay. So yeah, you and I should connect.
Sure.
There are a variety of other platforms. We believe ours is better, obviously.
So one last question from me, Pratik. What's the blue line? You're saying, could this all be easier? Is there something that, because we couldn't do the demos now, is there something that you want to leave in next week with for now?
Absolutely. So, yes. So we're coming out with a platform which will actually help you do all of what I just said, right? And think about everything that I just said, right? Collect a lot of data, but don't stop with collection, because you'll see a lot of platforms will stop with collection and give you pretty reports and charts, right? Actually, go ahead and segment users. Extremely powerful, right? And there's a super simple way in which we are allowing that. And finally, create assets. Target users, send specific messages, show ads to certain people, don't show ads to certain people. All of this in a very, very simple way. So certainly stay tuned, write me an email, and we'll certainly get back to you.
So Pratik, thanks a lot.
Thanks.
That's all we have time for. We've got a few good question vouchers that we can give out. So the best questions that you've heard.
Sure.
So this is
I'll get in touch with you.
So, and we have something for you, Pratik. Thanks a lot for coming and explaining the concept so beautifully.